हेलो। सो हाय गाइस, वेलकम टू अनदर सेशन ऑफ आरबीआई 247। माय नेम इज मानसी आनंद एंड आई वेलकम यू टू दिस सेशन। सो गाइस, एज मोस्ट ऑफ यू वुड बी नोइंग दैट इन दिस सेशन वी डिस्कस फाइव क्वेश्चंस व्हिच कैन बी ऑफ यूज टू यू इफ यू आर प्रिपेयरिंग फॉर कॉम्पिटिटिव एग्जाम्स। सो लेट्स नॉट वेस्ट एनी टाइम एंड मूव स्ट्रेट अवे टू क्वेश्चन नंबर वन। बट बिफोर डूइंग दैट आई वुड लाइक टू आस्क यू गाइस टू सब्सक्राइब टू अवर चैनल। So guys, if this is the first video of our channel that you are watching, then do not forget to hit the subscribe button and you can also press this bell icon. It can help you to get notified whenever a new video comes up. You can also join our Telegram group, and on this group you can post all your doubts and queries and we'll try to resolve them as soon as possible. You can also mention your doubts as comments on the videos and we'll try to take them up in these sessions. Right? Moving ahead to the first question for today. Okay, this is your first question and it talks about serial bonds. I hope the screen is perfectly visible. Let us read the question. This question says, following are some statements about serial bonds. Which of the following statements are not correct? Three statements given to you and you have to select the ones which are not right in relation to serial bonds. Guys, you can pause the video here. Give these statements a thorough read and then decide with your answer. Moving ahead to the solution, and the correct option for this question is option D, that is 1 and 2, which means 1 and 2 are not correct, whereas the third statement is correct. First of all, let us try to understand the meaning of serial bond and then we can come back to the question. Now talking about serial bond. So you know what is a bond? A bond is a financial instrument which allows an entity to raise money from other investors, right? So here is a borrower who needs money and this borrower raises this money from this lender. And what is the incentive to this lender to provide this money to borrower? Very simple. The borrower is going to pay interest to this lender on the bonds that this borrower has given to the lender, right? So lender has two incentives: interest that he is going to get on the bonds, and apart from that, the redemption amount, that is the amount of his investment that he is going to get back after the maturity of the bond expires. Let's say this is a 10-year-old bond. So for 10 years, the lender is going to earn interest income, and after 10 years, he is going to get his investment back when the bonds are going to be redeemed. Right? So this is a structure of a normal bond. Now coming to the topic of serial bonds. See, serial bonds are a little bit different from normal bonds because in case of serial bonds, the redemption does not happen at one time. It takes place in intervals, or you can say it takes place in different phases, different tranches. So if it is a 10-year-old bond, it might be possible that some bonds are reduced after, some bonds are redeemed after 2 years, then some more after 4 years, then some more after 6 years, and this goes on. Right? So basically, slowly and steadily, gradually, the burden of redeeming the bonds, the burden of giving back the money of lender, that becomes low, or that reduces, because some bonds are redeemed after a set time interval. So what is the structure of this redemption? This is usually mentioned in the contract or the agreement, right? So this is a serial bond. So this was asked by one of you in the comments, and the question was, what is the difference between a tap issue of bond and serial issue, right? So this is a serial issue. Tap issue we have also discussed in one of our previous sessions. So in tap issue, what happens is the issuance of bonds takes place in tranches. Like some are issued in this year, some will be issued after 2 months, some bonds will be issued after 4 months. Whereas in case of serial bond, the redemption takes place in tranches. So in tap issue, issuance takes place in phases or tranches, whereas in serial bonds, redemption takes place in phases or tranches, right? So this is what a serial bond is. I hope now you understand the concept. And this is why the first statement is not correct, because a serial bond is a bond that is issued in intervals. This is a wrong statement. A serial bond is a bond on which the redemption payment is made in intervals, right? After that, coming to the point, the cost of debt of serial bond is very high. This statement is also wrong. And why is that so? See, since the burden of redemption is reducing every year, that is why serial bonds are considered safer than bullet bonds. Bullet bonds in which, or the normal bonds in which redemption takes place in one go or at one particular time. So serial bonds are considered safer than bullet bonds. And why is that so? Because see, the debt is held till the end or till the maturity in case of bullet bonds. Whereas in serial bonds, the debt is getting reduced gradually when the redemption is taking place at different intervals. Right? Let's say there is a company which has raised 1 crore from the market in the form of bonds. Right? So after 2 years, it redeems 20 lakhs. So it returns money to... it returns money worth 20 lakhs. And after that, the debt which is left with the company is only 80 lakhs. Let's say after 2 more years, that is after a total of 4 years, they redeem 20 lakh more, which leaves the debt to 60 lakh. Whereas if this would have been a bullet bond, in that case, if we say the life of bond is 10 years, then this debt of 1 crore would have been held for 10 years. Right? So do you see the difference? The redemption is making the debt burden of the issuer lower gradually. That is why they are considered safer and the cost of borrowing is low because of the low risk associated with the serial bond. I hope now this concept is clear. And third statement is right. It says serial bond structure, common strategy for municipal revenue bonds. Why is it so? See, municipal bonds which are raised by municipalities or municipal authorities so that they can carry out their developmental work. So in this type of structure, what happens is an initial heavy payment is required. Let's say there is a municipality that needs to create a park in one colony, right? So that park creation is going to be a heavy investment of one time. But after that, let's say they put some shops in the park which provide rent to the authorities, and let's say there is some entry fees charged from charged to enter the park that provides some revenue. So municipality is going to earn the revenue in the future, but one time heavy payment is required. So this type of bond can be, this type of structure, serial bond structure can be helpful because it raises money in one go, but the redemption can be done slowly and steadily as per the future streams, future revenue streams follow. When you earn money, you try to pay them off gradually, right? And not a heavy burden is on the issuer for redemption, right? That is why it is common for municipal bonds or developmental works of municipalities. Moving ahead, you can see some more information. I think we have discussed most of it. Serial bonds repay the entire principal at the time of maturity. Bullet bonds or term bonds, they pay the entire principal at maturity, whereas serial bonds repay it in installments at regular intervals. Entire bond is sold to the public on same day. So the issuance is made on the same day, in contrast to the tap issue where issuance takes place in tranches, right? Maturity dates are stated in different. They are stated in offering document. And there is one more benefit. So these are issued by center and state governments and municipalities. We have discussed it. Here you can see some advantages and disadvantages of serial bond. First advantage is that not the entire amount becomes due on one single date. That is why the debt burden is reduced and it reduces the instances of default. As I told you, the cost of borrowing is less because of the low risk associated with these bonds, because debt burden gradually reduces. Lucrative for a wider pool of investors. Why is this so? Because see, it provides maturity at different rates. So it can attract those investors who want the redemption to be at a shorter term, at a shorter maturity, and they can attract those investors also who want the maturity to be a long-term maturity, right? So that is why more public is available, more target public is available to such issuers. It has a lower weighted average interest cost because of low risk associated. Disadvantages: reduces the risk of default, but they create reinvestment risk for the investors. So those investors who are investing into the short term part of serial bond, let's say there is an investor who has invested into a serial bond, but that investor is getting redemption after only 2 years of investing. So it might be possible that this serial bond is paying a good rate of interest, but in market the interest rates have fallen. That is why this investor now who has got the money back might not be able to invest this money as compared to the return on this serial bond, right? So there is reinvestment risk. We have discussed reinvestment risk in detail in one of our previous sessions. So especially in the case, in the environment where the interest rates are declining, there can be risk for investors, especially the short-term investors. And this should be issued only for the projects which generate consistent future flows. So if there is some project which is going to generate money after 10 years, for that particular situation, these bonds are not suitable because they start redemption in a shorter time as compared to bullet bonds, right? So this was about serial bonds. Moving ahead to the next question, here is the second question, which says select the correct statement in relation to the topic of fund overlap. And moving ahead to the solution, and the correct option for this question is option E. Option E means fund overlap can reduce portfolio diversification, creating concentrated positions. Now, first of all, for understanding this position, we should know the meaning of fund overlap. Guys, it's a very simple concept. The name itself tells you, fund overlap. Let's try to take an example. Let's say you have invested into two mutual funds. One mutual fund that follows the companies of Sensex, right? There is one mutual fund which invests into the companies which make part of Sensex. After that, you have invested into a mutual funds which invests into IT companies, right? So two different type of mutual funds, one investing into Sensex companies, one investing into IT companies. Now what happens is the top five companies of Sensex, it comprises of IT companies, right? So let's say that in Sensex, in the top 10, five are IT companies. And these five IT companies which are in this fund, they also form part of this fund because they are top IT firms. So do you see that both the funds, although you have tried to provide diversification by investing into an index fund and by investing into a thematic fund or sector oriented fund, but still both of the funds are investing into these huge five companies, right? So this is a fund overlap, that some companies that make part of one fund are also making the part of other fund. So that reduces your diversification because there are more number of common companies in both the funds, right? That is why fund overlap, it reduces your portfolio's diversification and it creates concentrated positions. So let's say if anything bad happens to the IT sector, then the value of this fund is going to fall and this fund is also going to fall because of reduced diversification. Basically, your investment is concentrated into a few companies rather than being scattered or diversified into different companies. That is why this option is correct. I hope you understand the meaning of fund overlap. So this is one problem of investors that needs to be sorted by careful analysis. Okay, here you can see some more information. A situation where an investor owns shares in several mutual funds with overlapping positions creates concentration in just a few companies. Overlap can be reduced. Now, how we can reduce it? By identifying which securities a fund holds before deciding to purchase its she knows. So one and only method to solve this problem of fund overlap is careful analysis. You check the funds, the companies in which the mutual fund is investing, and then try to invest in those funds which comprise of different companies, right? So this is the method to reduce overlap. For example, if two separate mutual funds both have overweighted, the same stock might be worth replacing one of the funds. So this is an example given to you that if you have invested in two funds which have overweighted same stock, then it is better to replace one fund with another fund in which those particular stocks are underweighted, because it creates a hedging position, right? So I hope now you are clear with this concept. Moving ahead to the third question. Here is the third question, which says, Mr. Shaitan Kapoor manages a hedge fund. He has outsourced the administration of his fund to Scam and Run Financials, but he has a doubt that his third party fund administrator is making too many mistakes. So third party administrator refers to Scam and Run Financials. To address this concern, he wants to put in place a system which will help him reconcile the records maintained by the third party administrator or to the firm to whom this work is outsourced, and the records which are maintained by fund itself. Now his friend Mr. Parishan Gupta, who is a financial expert, has told him about a system that he can use. Could you guess the name of this system? And the correct option for this question is option A. Option A means shadow accounting. Okay, so first of all, we are talking about funds here, probably hedge funds. See, this is an increasing trend. If you are managing a fund that puts money into different investments, you definitely need to monitor it, right? And there are many calculations. I mean, there are so many calculations associated with managing a fund that sometimes it becomes difficult for the management itself to do it. And that is why they outsource this job of managing the calculations to some third party known as fund administrator. So basically they are outsourcing the administrator of the fund. So they are known as fund administrator, right? So I hope till now things are clear. Hedge fund outsourcing their fund administration to a third party. Now obviously both of them are going to maintain some records, right? And there are going to be some differences between both of them. So guys, if you remember, when you have a passbook with a bank in which you are having an account, you go to bank and reconcile the passbook. Why is reconciliation done? So that to check that you have entered the same transactions that bank is entering, right? So similar is the work here. The fund which has outsourced the administration needs to reconcile the records between the two and check whether this firm who has taken the outsourced work is doing its work properly or not, right? And for this, a system called shadow accounting can be used. Now, where does shadow accounting come into the scene? It refers to this hedge fund maintaining records so that it can reconcile it with this firm, right? Here you can see some more information. Okay, many investment firms outsource their administration. Fund administration typically comprises of services like calculation of NAV. So these are the activities which can be outsourced by the firm. Calculation of NAV, daily, weekly or monthly profit and loss reporting, fees calculations and other activities. The reasons for using a third party. Why are these activities being outsourced? Because it typically includes investors' preference for an independent firm to oversee a fund's financials. Obviously, one reason is specialization, that the fund is offloading their burden and outsourcing these calculations to another third party. One reason is specialization and offloading their burden. Another reason is that investors today, they want the calculation to be done by a third party. Because see, if the hedge fund whose reputation is associated, they can also do some they can also mislead the investors by making some calculations, by making some by doing window dressing to the accounts. They can manipulate the accounts in their own terms to protect their reputation or to build a good reputation. That is why investors want that these calculations should be done by a third party which is independent in nature, so that it can bring out any wrongdoings or any errors in the records, in the financial records of the fund, right? So one reason is this for outsourcing. Now, shadow accounting, process of maintaining an additional set of financial books for the purposes of comparison with the third party administrator. So under shadow accounting, this hedge fund, apart from maintaining its own records, maintains another set of books so that it can later reconcile. See, whatever activities it is outsourcing, the major portions of it, this hedge fund can also maintain so that later they can reconcile and they can check whether the third party is doing their job properly or not. So they are like creating a shadow of this third party. That is why this is called the process of shadow accounting, right? Shadow accounting can be used to describe broad range of practices from verifying a third party administrator's NAV calculations. So basically, they try to replicate some of the major jobs that are being outsourced to the third party. Obviously, that involves cost and time, but it involves verification of the job of third party as well, right? Moving ahead to the next question. And here is the fourth question for today, which says, select the odd one out in terms of counterparty risk. Moving ahead to the solution, very simple question. The correct option for this question is option C. Option C means credit life insurance. Okay, so first of all, talking about the counterparty risk. Counterparty risk, which basically means that you have extended loan to someone and that particular person is not paying you back. So that chances of that borrower not paying you back is known as the counterparty risk, right? You can simply learn it from the example that, let's say you and your friend go out to watch a movie. Your friend forgot the wallet at home. That is why you pay your friend and your friend never pays you back for that movie, right? So that is counterparty risk. Now, there are many insurance firms that provide you with insurance in case of businesses. Try to apply the same situation in businesses that, let's say there is a seller who has sold the goods to a buyer. Now, buyer has got a credit period of 3 months, but after 3 months, this buyer who has already taken the possession of goods disagrees to make the payment. So obviously seller is at a loss, but let's say seller has taken an insurance. There is a company which promises the seller that if you give us some premiums, you make some payments to us, in case of any problem, we are going to pay you back in case you have a problem recovering your payments, right? So this is basically credit insurance, ensuring the safety of your credit which has been extended, right? So the first point, trade credit insurance, refers to the same situation. And if the situation happens in an international transaction, then it can be export credit insurance, basically protecting the exporter from the risk of not getting paid, right? Because the exporter is selling goods globally or to another country. After that, credit insurance is also the similar term. Trade credit basically refers to the short-term credit which is extended while selling the goods. After that, business credit insurance, it also refers to the same purpose. But here, credit life insurance is a different concept. For understanding credit life insurance, let us take an example. Refers to Mr. X. So this is a person, Mr. X. Mr. X recently passed away in an accident. And he was a young man, he was not an old man. And he has got some credit card payments. Like, before his death, he was unable to meet the credit card payments of, let's say, worth 5 lakh. Now, the lenders are going to harass his family for to recover this amount of 5 lakh. But if Mr. X has taken some insurance called credit life insurance and paid premiums to this particular insurance, then in case of his death, credit life insurance is going to pay this much amount to his credit card issuing company or credit card issuing bank, right? So basically, credit life insurance helps a person to pay off his or her debts in case that person is not able to do so because of death, right? So see, here the person who has taken the insurance has insured his own debts, payments of his own debts. Whereas in case of other options, in case of credit insurance, the payment which is to be received by another party is insured. In case of credit life insurance, the payment which has to be paid to another party. So here, received from other party has to be insured, and here the payment which has to be made to the other party is insured, right? So this is the difference between credit life insurance and the rest of the terms. Moving ahead to the solution, here you can see trade credit offered by vendors, right? And it is very important to extend the credit or provide an alternative to payment if you want to sell your goods in the market, right? This requires the vendor to assume the non-payment risk or the credit risk. Obviously, vendor or seller is facing the credit risk, right? The risk increases when loss customs communication. So, in an international transaction, this risk amplifies. So, in addition to increased risk for non-payment, international trade presents the problem of time between product shipment, availability for sale. So basically, there are more complex problems in case of international transaction. So trade credit insurance, the concept of trade credit insurance comes to the rescue here and provide an insurance to the person who has to receive payment from other party. Insurance policy, risk management product offered by insurance companies to protect the insured from the loss due to credit risk, such as protected default, insolvency or bankruptcy of the borrower, right? This should not be confused with credit life insurance or credit disability insurance, which are different concepts altogether. Moving ahead to the last question for today. So this is the last question, which says, which of the following problem arises due to asymmetrical information? Moving ahead to the solution, which says that the correct option is option B, that is the lemons problem. Guys, this is a very interesting concept in economics, the lemons problem. What is the meaning of lemons problem? Okay, basically it was a research done by an economist, right? He was talking about the sale of second-hand cars, right? Now, in the context of these second-hand cars, he says whenever a buyer wants to buy a second-hand car, there is some asymmetrical information. That means the buyer cannot be sure of the car's quality before buying it, right? When the buyer buys it and uses it, then only he will get to know whether this purchased car is good or not, right? So he classifies the bad cars or the defective cars, which the buyer is not able to figure out at the time of buying, as lemons, right? So see, if you are going to buy a second hand car, you don't want to buy a lemon, because lemon means a bad car. Lemon is just a term given to a bad car who is not worth its value, right? So you do not want to buy a lemon. But how can you be sure of it, that this particular car which is being shown to you by the seller, and the seller is appreciating it so much that everything is fine, it is not run too much, the engine is fine. How can you figure out that this is a good car and this is not a lemon? So you know that you are at a disadvantage, or you have asymmetrical information. Because why asymmetrical? Because see, if you had the same information as the seller obviously knows what is good and what is bad in the car, whether the car is a lemon or not, but you do not know that. So there is asymmetry of information between seller, who knows about the car, but the buyer who does not know about the car. So do you see information asymmetry? Buyer does not know it. Now buyer being the smart person that he is, what does buyer do? Buyer tries to fix an average price for all the cars, right? Whatever price is being charged, the highest or the lowest, tries to figure out the average price between the average price. The buyer tries to figure out an average price between the highest and lowest price charged. Why is buyer figuring out the average price? Because he thinks if he gets a good car, then good for him, because he is getting it at a lower value. And if he gets a bad car, if he gets a lemon, then his loss would not be too much. He would not have paid a very high price, right? So that is why he tries to fix an average price. This might seem like an insurance to the buyer, but obviously the buyer is at a disadvantage if he gets a lemon. If he buys the lemon at average price, see, this average price is found between price of the lowest price charged and the highest price charged. It is like a midpoint between highest price and lowest price. Now this lemon, which is a bad car, deserves this low price, and a good car, which is not a lemon, deserves a high price. Now if the buyer gets a lemon in the average price, then obviously buyer is at a disadvantage because he is getting a bad car at an average price and it deserved a lower price. But if the buyer gets this, if a buyer gets this good car at the average price, then the seller is at the loss because he has to sell this good car which deserves higher price than the average price at an average price. Right, so that is why this is the paradox, or this is the problem. This is called the lemon's problem. Because of information asymmetry, there is the buyer has to decide a midpoint which can be a loss in the situation he buys a lemon, right? And can be a loss in the situation if the buyer gets a good car in the price of an average car. So this concept is called a lemon's problem. Some more information about this lemon's problem, put forward in a research paper by George Akerlof. Right, tag phrase identifying. Example of used cars Akerlof used to illustrate the concept of asymmetric information. Basically, here Akerlof is trying to present, or he is trying to put forward the idea that because there is information asymmetry, that is why the good commodities are not able to have a higher price. There is a possibility of a good commodity not having a price which is true to its value, and there is a possibility of a lemon or a bad product getting a higher price that it does not deserve. That is a problem, right? As defective used cars are commonly referred to as lemons, right? Problems exist for both consumers and the business products. Also in the arena of investing, so this problem can also be applied to the area of investing, where there are buyers and sellers and there is asymmetry between them. So they can try to transact at an average price which might not be good, which might put one party at a disadvantage. Potential buyer of a car cannot ascertain the true value. They may be willing to pay no more than an average price, which they perceive as somewhere between the bargain price and the premium price, right? Lemon problem is also prevalent in the financial sector, including insurance and credit markets. So the loss of lemon problem is that good price discovery is not efficient and good products are not able to get their true value in the market, whereas consumer might suffer if he buys a lemon, right? Okay. So guys, these were the 5 questions for today. I hope you learned something new from this video. If you did, then do not forget to hit the like button. Guys, I would like to discuss an article which was mentioned by Mridula in the comments. And this article was by Raghuram Rajan in Live Mint on the 2nd December. And this article is called, "Just How Much Debt Is Too Much For Any Country To Safely Issue." See, this is a simple article, which might appear to be really technical or which might appear to be difficult, but if you read it carefully, it is very simple, and it simply says that according to the modern monetary theory, we think that it is easier to create money and it is easier to infuse liquidity in the market in times of crisis, because now the central banks can print money, right? But this cannot go on. This can go till a time, or this procedure of printing money can go on till when the government is able to maintain its illusion of credit worthiness in the eyes of investor, right? See, because government, they do not have to redeem the bonds that they issue, because they can reissue the bonds or they can issue new bonds to cover that payment, right? So this cycle can go on, but this can only go on till a point where, till when the market has or the buyers have confidence in the bonds of a country. Because we have seen, guys, if you remember, we have discussed about Eurozone crisis, the Eurozone sovereign debt crisis. So countries can also default. We think that government bonds are safe, but countries can also default. We have seen this in the times of crisis of Eurozone, right? So basically, Rajan wants to say that here, that printing money or deficit printing is not a bad thing. It is not a sin that should not be used by countries. It can be used, because many a times it becomes very important for countries to have money if they want to spend on infrastructure and development, right? As in the times of pandemic. But we cannot use it as a cash cow, and we cannot keep using it. Ultimately, we will have to convert this spending of money into revenues for government in the forms of taxation and other non-tax revenue, because government needs to generate revenue. They cannot keep on printing money, because once the market, see what is going to happen in the long term, if they are not able to put this money to good use, to productive use, and they keep printing money, that one day will come and investors will lose the confidence and no one is going to buy their bonds. And if no one is going to buy their bonds, how are you going to raise money as government, right? Then you would have to declare yourself as a defaulter and you would not have any single penny to spend on your country, right? So in short term, it might work till the point governments are able to put this printed money to good use, right? So this was the gist of this big article, and I hope you find it beneficial. So guys, I will see you in the next session. Till then, you take care of yourself, keep your studies carrying on, and thank you for being here.